Cubs High School in the 1960s. So I've been here for 8 years old in this area. And I'm here basically with the same ideas that Mr. Pickle has. I'm a retired Teamster. And now with the new law regarding the pension, my pension's going to get cut right in half. And Mr. Walter is right behind he voted for it, and now he is so super set on defending it. And I was at the meeting Monday, and he basically laughs at us. And this is it's 73 years old, and now I'm unable to work. I'm on total disability with an autoimmune disease, and I'm supposed to pick up the difference, which is going to be I'm going to lose $1,400 a month, which calculates out to almost $17,000 a year when you're 17 or 73 years old and you cannot recover from this. This is my whole financial future. I get Social Security. I'm on Social Security disability. But my pension for 29 years being a Teamster that I worked for, and we took small wage increases to have the money put into the Teamster pension fund. And now, in 10 years, they say it's going to be questionable. And they've come up with this program to rescue the pension fund. And it's basically what's happening to 10,000 people in the central states area as the pension is getting cut in half.
More than 10,000.
For
40,000 of us in Michigan, and there's 412,000 of us all together
there.
40,000 of us in Michigan. And Mr. Wahlberg, I'd like to add something to Mr. Wahlberg, what he's done for us. I started going to his meetings trying to persuade him. There's legislation to roll this kind of back. They want to put some tax on the hedge funds to make up the difference, to reimburse pension funds and everything else. Mr. Walter doesn't want to support legislation. One part of the legislation, or the other legislation, put in by Republicans to Portman in Ohio. Walter won't even get on board with that. His answer to that is, these things aren't going to pass. Bring me something that will work and I'll get on board with it. Well, I don't know how many of you here are familiar, but they post, just like you do, they post where they're going to be for these meetings. Here's what Mr. Walter has done to it. We will not post where he's going to be now because we show up 15, 30 people. And we want to know, what are you going to do about it? He works for us, too. We know how this works.
We work for you first.
Right. And whether I'm a Republican or Democrat, he's still half his salary is coming from me, a poor Democrat. But he doesn't want to show up at these meetings with us there. So what he's doing, he's sending letters to registered Republicans only. And we know this because his neighbor got one. He's a registered Republican. In Ida last week, he wanted to keep it the good old boys club meeting in his coffee hour by sending letters to registered Republicans only. Well, his neighbors told him about it, so he went down there with his wife and several other couples and their wives. Wahlberg got mad.
Well, he was mad.
Okay, we're here to talk about solving problems. I appreciate your concerns. So we'll finish introductions,
yes, sure.
And then I'll talk a little bit about my background and like that, some of all these issues. There's a lot. We have a lot of issues, as I know that's why there's a lot of people here. So would you like...
Tom Housekeeper, simply put, Jim Wahlberg does not represent the people of this district. He has a great deal of money for the growth at all. Is there a way to generate enough money
But we're actually basically right now just introducing ourselves and where we're from, if you're from Tecumseh, just a little bit about, because this is really a community coffee. So, I'm here to really hear about issues. I'm happy to talk about that campaign also. But I'm trying to learn what in Tecumseh and in this county, what are the community issues that are important?
My wife.
Okay, so thank you, but we can talk.
I'm Pat Housekeeper, I served on the city council for 14 years.
Okay, so a little bit about me, as I think some of you know, I'm a state representative in my second term, and I'm currently on minority chair of elections on agriculture and communications and technology. And I'm, the reason I'm on those committees is I'm concerned about the issues I've worked on rural broadband, specifically since I started in the legislature in 2013. And also agriculture is a really important and very big part of Washington County. We have a lot of agriculture economy is very strong in my district. And so that's also a very important economic sector of our state. So that's the reason I'm on that committee. And obviously, it talks a little bit about elections. We are one of the bottom five states in the country for improving voter access in the last 20 years. We've done nothing to improve voter access. So we're talking about doing something, you know, right now. So we are going to be doing some amendments. We have 18 amendments that are bills that Democrats have introduced this term to try to improve online registration. No reason absentee voter. There's so many things that other states are doing to improve voter access. That we are not doing in Michigan. So we're trying to tie part of those to this bill that's coming through that you're hearing about on the radio. And then, last term I was on transportation and commerce, and I asked not to be on transportation. It was clearly leadership driven. Even though I spent a lot of time in local government working on transportation funding and infrastructure in a leadership role, I was appointed by the governor to represent all the cities, Governor Granholm to represent all the cities around the state around transportation and the needs and efficiencies that we are doing in local government. My input wasn't, but there was no opportunity. So it's a very, right now, in 19, it's very hard to provide a majority, and it's a very hard to have some of the conversations that we're trying out, which is coming together to work together softly. And I come from local government. So I was mayor of Sweeney for 14 years, and before that I was on city council for 6 years. And it was nonpartisan. When I ran for office as a Democrat in 19, I did not run. I was not a Democrat for those 20 years. And I was actually, I didn't even know who on my council was Democrat or Republican when I ran. Like, people were like, well, who? I'm like, I don't know. And we never talked about it, right? Because we talked about solving our community problems. And somehow we've gotten away from that. And I went to Nancy to tell you how that conversation went. Proposal A doesn't work anymore for our schools and our communities. It was based on the voting agreement. So we have legislation in Lansing that is not helping our state and our people. And, you know, so I went to Lansing trying to help improve things. We've been making some progress, but we have a lot of work to do. And so a lot of the reason, I've been doing a lot of work on that, but there's a great opportunity here to have a bigger, broader conversation around federal government. So this is, it's overarching. It affects all the semi-professional industry and would affect our state government and the legislature at the state level also. I'm a strong congressperson in semi-professional district, and that's what I'm running. My platform has always been, from the day that I first ran the local government, is working alongside community members, solid problems in the community. So back then, when I first ran, Celine's downtown was two businesses. It was really small. There was not a lot of equity development in downtown, and I campaigned on that issue. Needless to say, I ran unopposed, so I didn't really have to have a issue. But I feel it's really important to have a conversation and talk to people and learn what the issues are in each community. I think there are overarching issues. You know, education is the primary issue. Our children, our early education, higher education, that's our future. And we all will be relying on them to be successful when we age, right? So I think that we are not investing in our children and enough in the state we have. You know, 25% of our kids are living in poverty. That's sick. I mean, we're in the United States of America. How is it that 25% of our kids are living in poverty? So education, the environment, and quality of life around infrastructure and the environment, I'm very interested in renewable energy. Yeah. We have a lot of work to do on that. The bills that are coming out of the State House. And as you know, federal, there's a lot of interest in so I think those are my core issues. Right now I'm really trying to learn, so I believe that there are overarching issues, and then obviously income stagnation, wage stagnation, what's happening to you is a little different, but it's contributing to the whole challenge of, you know, people are not making enough money to take care of their people, and they're working multiple jobs to do that, or losing their job, losing their pension, and it's just not sustainable for our future. So those are the big overarching issues, but I know that everybody had specific questions, and so I wanted to just really quickly introduce myself. When I was mayor, I campaigned as mayor on regional land use planning. I think it's very important to work, to be strategic and thoughtful about government. There is such a thing as good government. I believe in it. I work hard for it. My city hall employees work diligently to come up with new solutions as our revenues continue to shrink. We did end up having to lay off almost 20% of our workforce, most of whom have not come back because that proposal has not been addressed. We continue to shrink revenues. So that's a challenge. And what's happening in Lansing, and I see it, you know, at the federal level, is we're not, we're talking about business tax cuts while shrinking government, and it's not sustainable in Lansing. Well, the roads package takes half of the funding for the roads infrastructure is going to come from the general fund. That's schools and communities ultimately, because it's mental health. I spent a lot of time with our county mental health department on Tuesday. They said they have literally their community health general fund dollars have gone from 6 million to 2 million. They have active suicidal people that have no place to play. In Washington, that's actually a more healthy county where there's more per capita incomes higher. So, you know, think about that statewide, we have a big challenge. So I'm really trying to learn a lot here in Lenawee County about what's happening on the ground. But I know that I've been in it as a local government leader, felt the compression on public schools. Observed that. I've talked to a lot. I work very closely with my communities. I'm sorry for talking about that. I worked a lot with my schools and communities as a state legislator. I'm very familiar with some of the issues, but I wanted to learn more. And I know this is, running for federal office is new, right? So I have a lot to learn, and I'm here to learn from you. And I think hopefully we can learn together about issues that we can address. So I know some of you had questions, like, what's that?
I just kind of wanted your background a little bit more, and I'd like to know some ideas of what your ideas are about solutions to some of these problems. I want to know what your views are on Planned Parenthood. Do you know anything about the sobriety courts in Michigan? Where the money goes, how much money comes in, who gets it?
Not very much.
Not very much money?
I don't know that much about it. Okay. Right, where it's at. I can find out more. Is it something that you need to, do you know about them and you want to educate me, or you want to work?
Well, I know some, a little bit, but my impression is, and I think we're up there, but my impression is that it's a nice scam to get money from the state. And I'm just hearing about another tax on the speeding ticket, and maybe it's all kind of tax tickets. You don't just pay the speeding ticket, you pay an extra $50 as opposed to the state. It's all these fees that keep going to the state.
So we cut that back. The driver responsibility fees was cut back significantly. I don't think it's completely eliminated, but there were a lot of fees tacked on earlier. But that should have been cut back. So, as far as Planned Parenthood, I support Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood provides health services to men and women, because I'm just a woman, and it's a very important role in our communities.
What about the big farming that's helping to pollute our waters and our waterways?
Well, so I've been working, that's one of the things that under environment that I've been working on, clean water actively. I introduced a bill recently that is a way to measure our surface waters. It's a citizen's, it's called crowd hydrology, and it's a way for citizens to actually engage in it. Basically, you put kind of like a yardstick in a stream, and people that go by can text a number that will be assigned on the yardstick that will text, and then you say what it's at, and it's basically a way to measure the flow, which then helps with the nutrient load, but then they're able to manage the water database, and that will help with nutrient overloads and also climate change as the, it's a way to monitor and inform the U.S. Geological Survey, which is the people that do projections and data analysis. And where I'm working with is the Water Research on that. I'm also working with the Farm Bureau and the DEQ around. We've had some meetings, we continue to have meetings. Yes, that's the way there have been measurements, and I'm working on it right now at the state level. I don't have,
But what are they, do they have solutions? Do they have some ideas about how to, monitoring it and finding out, oh, this is what it is and how bad it is?
Well, so, they're interested. I think at the end of the day, we have the same, that's one reason I'm on agriculture, right? We have the same goals. I work very closely with agriculture. I think we have the same goals. They need clean water, just like we need clean water. So it's not us and them. In my mind, we need to improve when there's nutrient runoff, identify the sources, and improve, keep that from happening. And I have met with some folks from the agriculture community, and they are working on improving it. I guess is the best way. The one that was the most violations was closed down. So I don't remember the name of it. I don't want to say yes, so I don't remember.
Quick question on the same topic. Are you aware of the farm subsidies and how they work around here? The handful of the richest farmers are getting these subsidies when they really don't need it, and their subsistence people are getting by on nothing. But what's we got to change that? That's not right. How we're just dishing them $1 million a year. I know there's one attempt in particular. Get these massive subsidies.
I think the Farm Act, actually the last one,
addressed it.
Yeah, some of that, and I don't have specific details on that. But
I didn't read details on that. I didn't hear anything.
I know there was some change to the subsidies that program, but I don't have the level to tell at the federal level on that. But that is an interesting question. So,
do you find it hard to monitor the farm with the right farm act?
Well, there is a certification program in the state implemented. That's a good program, and there are more and more farms coming online with that. A lot of the farms are, have been for a long time. These farms are a very important part of our community. And I think, again, it's a matter of working with them to help solve the problems. And, I urge the folks to, can we figure out a way to improve the relationships and communication? So if there is nutrient runoff from a farm, what can we do to address that? And so that's some of the things that we're trying to do. And then also the program along, district, the 7th commercial goes from Monroe up to Lansing. I don't know if it's Grand River, I can't remember the name of it. There's one further west and north, but I can't remember the name of it. The one that for me seems to be the most challenging, and I and also have personal experience when I was the mayor's lead. We were members of the River Basin Watershed, and it's kind of had a cyclical. So I really think that there's a huge opportunity with the challenges that happen with drinking water and get that out of the park. I had a coffee in Monroe two weeks ago, and they're all worried about. So I really think it's a there's a huge opportunity to come together. But again, it's about finding the financial wherewithal to make an investment and having a regional look at such an important issue. So that's it's kind of challenging the way the current bylaws are set up. If there's like 60 governing bodies that are members and they don't always have a quorum because that's a lot of elected officials to get together. You know, so I think there's some, and I'm not saying this in a negative way because they've done a lot. They had a great person there for a while. This change, but I think there's some opportunities. That's the best way I would put it. And I think it's huge. So any of you that are interested in that, I would urge you to talk to your local government people and talk to them about, you know, getting engaged and really moving them because there are some great opportunities to raise awareness. And that's one of the reasons I'm excited about that crop hydrology piece because a lot of people don't think about their water, right? I grew up on the East Coast, but I grew up camping and my dad actually passed away last year, but he was on the Connecticut River watershed. So he's very engaged in the environment. A moderate Republican. So I grew up in a moderate Republican household. And I will tell you that Joe Schwartz is the first of campaign. I worked very closely with him when I was mayor in the city. So I do believe that we all come together with good ideas to solve problems, and that's my fingers, that's my goal. And I'm looking for opportunities to do that regularly. So the crop hydrology piece of bringing people and giving them the opportunity to engage in thinking about their water and keeping it clean, and I think just having that kind of thinking, that part of your brain being more aware, it just starts that, you know, that interest and long-term goals. So other questions? Yes.
I think all of this is important. Our current congressman has responsibilities in the committee assignments in Washington, some of which where he could interject influence on such issues as the future of the Postal Service, the future of Lake Erie, the future of fresh water in the Great Lakes, the future of the Great Lakes. These are huge public policy decisions, and we frankly have someone who either knows precious little or wishes never to use the mind that God gave them. And I think we need a lot more activity at the public policy issues and putting these people on the spot. You're either with us or you're against us. And I know that runs counter to your view of let's get together and solve problems. I guess I've moved because I too am 73, and I've pretty much had it with the incrementalism the Democrats are so good at. I want to see some action, and I am absolutely sick of what's going on in this state. And there are too few of us standing up. I mean, do something.
I'm 73, and all I got to say is amen.
But, I mean, what we just heard about how we are discouraged from attending the current congressman's visits to the district, to the point where it gets angry at people who are concerned about health care and pensions.
I'm still going, by the way.
Yeah, well, my view is, let's get half dozen of us there and picket every one of his meetings. Let's make sure we alert the press what a mediocre man and that he is. Really, I mean, I sound like I'm a little off my rocker, but quite honestly, there's not much else gonna happen.
It's obviously gonna talk. He does not represent the people in this district.
Well, that's where I'm running.
And he does not represent the people in this district, and we need a candidate who can win. And it's going to take a lot of money and a lot of support from the Democratic Party.
We can win. We can win. Senator Peters won in the 7th congressional last year. We can win. I actually sit in a highly gerrymandered. My district currently goes the northeast corner of Washtenaw County. If you look at the map, it's all the way over in Salem Township. So all the way over in the northeast corner, all the way over to the northwest corner. So Whitmore Lake, all the way over to Chelsea, down to Manchester, over to Saline, carves out all the way in Arbor, just goes all the way around. So it's highly gerrymandered to be a Republican district. So we won because we talked to voters, we listened to voters, So it's about, you know, yes, we need money to get your message out, but at the end of the day, we need to do what you're talking about, which is talking to voters, right? I need you to talk to your friends and neighbors, and we all need to work together, because we can represent our country. It's not just about money. Money does have, we have to have enough to get our message out, but at the end of the day, it's really about talking to each other about the things that are happening, that are eroding, you know, the American lifestyle has been,
if you talk about helping middle class, that's all they do is talk to them.
Yeah.
We're all sick of it.
And there's a lot of education that needs to go around that, right? So this, for example, the pull-up, this pension, this law.
Mr. Wahlberg's on the committee of pension, by the way.
So there's a lot, you know, for me, the things that I've been learning, I'm not as aware of the pension because that has not been a state issue. But for me, the issue is around education. That has been the cuts we're making. Two things that we've been doing in Michigan in particular is cutting funding for, I think, our core things that are most important for our future, which is education, environment, and then also cutting business taxes to where there's almost no business tax rate. We used to have almost $2 billion, we have less than $500 million in that category. So, and also, shifting, there was a huge tax shift to our citizens in 2012 when we did that business tax adjustment. So we're just continuing to compress the living wages of our citizens.
Hey, something else the Snyder administration's done that most people sitting here don't know either. He's released a lot of convicted felons onto the street because they want to get the prison population down to about 43,000 inmates. When he took office, it was about 48,000. So he's taken these guys under prison sentencing laws. You get a 3 to 5. Well, if you're a jerk when you come to prison, you're going to stay the full 5. Under the new terms with the Snyder administration, you serve that 3 years, you're getting back on the street. We're going to do everything we can to get these inmates back out on the street. They can be a total jerk in prison and still get out early. And then what he's doing, look at the books on the ones that he's letting out. They get out of prison, they've been in prison for a drug offense, they get dropped from the initiative of parole officers. Okay? It used to be, under the old system, you come in there and drop dirty, you're going right back to prison. We put you back in prison, like to serve out the rest of the sentence. Okay? Now they come back in there, they drop dirty, back home. After you do about 3 times, you drop dirty, then you get to spend about 3 days in county jail. You never get sent back to prison. The reason they're doing this is the Snyder administration wants to keep the recidivism rate, where they can say when he came into office, that recidivism rate is how many come back in prison and get released. Under when he came into office, it was probably like 67%. These guys commit felons come back in prison. What he's done by doing this is saying, oh, with these programs that I put in, this and this, recidivism rate has gone down from 67 to 55. But all he's doing is not sending them back to prison, but they're sitting there keeping them out of the streets with the rest of us.
Okay.
Look in the books where I come from.
Yeah, totally different. They're trying to do that with the parks office. What are they doing here? They're paying them the debt with this. Pension in hand, 75. What are you going to do? Everything will be private. I mean, even the school bus
I think it's very short-sighted because those costs end up if you're going to provide services, it's got to cost money. And prioritization, what they're doing is they do a very, we had to look at that. There's been local land more over the years. You make it cheaper. couple of buses. I was at a coffee meeting, I think it was Adrian, and they were talking about buses.
$8 or $9 an hour versus the state is paying like $18 or $20 an hour. They're paying people $8 or $9 an hour. But the bad thing is the caliber of people you were getting were bringing in drugs. They were having affairs with the inmates.
Yeah, the air marshal. We should have canceled that contract.
You know,
they shouldn't have ever gone that way. But.
The problem is, though, they replaced their drugs, okay? But the problem was, you know what I'm getting at. Yeah, I'm not telling you a secret.
Hi, Gretchen. If you will, picture around this table. Alright? Picture around this table, instead of these French folks in the room, picture an audience, a mixture of moderate Republicans and independents. Independents who perhaps might have voted for Tim Walmer last time around, all right? What would you say to me? Would you have a special message for them? What kind of a message would you have for somebody who was a little bit soft on Tim? And here to hear you speak.
I think I would just talk about my background. You know, the work that we've done and the fact of the matter is that we have a lot of families and children that are struggling and we're not solving problems.
When you think about talking about his background, like the sources of the major contributions he gets, what the agendas of these people are, and how the enactment of these agendas might affect me, might affect you, him, her. He had the distinction, what was it, 4 or 5 years ago of receiving the most money of any congressman from the Crooks.
$7 for every voting
guy. That's quite a distinction. I don't know if he has a medal or a plaque on his wall or not, but probably doesn't need one.
Where do you support
what I really support what Larry's talking about? What we need to identify, the only way we can win, can we win, for example, the only way we can win is what Larry has suggested, and that is to understand not the faithful here, but the independents and the moderate Republicans, and understand their issues and speak to those issues. You've got our voters. We have tried several times, we've made phone calls, we've knocked on them, we've worked our heads off and failed each and every time because it was difficult for me.
Yes, those are the voters that need education.
Yeah. Here's the issue that I think is most prominent in an agricultural community, and that is the environmental damage that these paper farms have done to the land and to now Lake Erie, which is dying again. And we do know that $2.5 million a year is being paid to one of the biggest polluters in the whole state. And he is a personal friend who has contributed to Mr. Walbert from the beginning of his run for political office. Now, I have personally seen his farm. I have friends who go out and monitor the water. My God, she's got enough reams of paper to fill up this room with results from monitoring water through the Sierra Club and through, but when you take it to the state, there's always some glitch that they can't look at it, and it doesn't go anywhere. So the frustration of people living with stench and a 50-foot pile of manure, within a mile of their house and smelling the stuff coming in our direction, that's air pollution. We can't nail this guy on that because we have $2.5 million going to him out of the agriculture assessment. I have talked to Debbie Stabenow about this. These men don't deserve that, and their reaction to its smell is, it's the smell of money. That's the response he gave to someone saying, how can you stand the odor of Mr. Warner that is coming out of your farm? It's the smell of money. They don't care. They want to go around and buy up property
because there are poor farmers out there that if we reach them, I think we can persuade them that maybe they are voting for the wrong guy if they want to have their health and well-being looked after. And to me, the environmental issue in this county is one of the biggest, most important issues. And if you don't talk about that, you may as well forget getting any votes from Lenawee County that are in the moderate independent category, because they're not going to come.
I agree with you. That is, Larry's question is, how can you attract moderate incumbents? She gave you the answer. That is your expertise. That is the way you can get money from Washington. That's the issue that you need.
Tell you another issue. Walbert's voting record.
Well, that's very clear. We all know
that. Yeah.